continue with Takashi giving a talk about first star formation.
All right. Thank you. So I'm talking about the formation of primordial stars. So this is a review. So I'm Takashi Hosokawa, and actually my affiliation is has just changed. I moved just 2 weeks ago to the Kyoto, the place of the picture Daniel Gali showed you with Francesco Palla. So I'm very happy to give a talk here. So let's start. So I'm talking about the primordial star formation. So as you know, the primordial stars or population three stars initiate the structure formation in the early universe, as you know. So very important, and so like these stuff, like reionization and creation of very fast heavy elements. But the above all depends on so what kind of stars they are. So for example, so maybe you know the primary population three stars should be some massive stars, but how massive typically? Or so what is the shape, exact shape of the mass distribution like the IMF? And what is a minimum or the maximum stellar masses? And for what about the binarity or the multiplicity of these population three stars? So this is another issue. And what kind, so what about the internal rotation of the, population three stars, so which can determine the property of a star. So to answer these questions, so we are studying the formation, detailed formation process of population three stars. But actually, the answers for these questions are still unknown. But so I'm reviewing the current status of the current achievement of these issues. So before entering the particular population three star formation, so I'm talking about the general outline of the star formation process. So roughly speaking, the star formation process can be divided into the two phases, two different phases, the first phase and second phase. And the first phase, everything is very dynamical. The star forming cloud is just collapsing dynamically by the self-gravity. So in this stage, the genes mass is an important quantity. And with this argument, with this equation of state, the gamma value of gamma is important. With the gamma less than 4 stars, the cloud can collapse. And what determines the gamma? The gamma actually depends on the cooling process. And the cooling process is, for the primordial case, the cooling process is just determined by the chemistry, like the, the hydrogen molecule is an important coolant. So that's why the chemistry is important. So in this case, so as I said, everything is dynamical, but finally, the star is forming, so like the protostar. The self-gravity is balanced by the pressure gradient. So at some moment, there is a star. So that is the beginning of the second phase, so which is the accretion phase. So in this phase, the star is there, but initially, the stellar mass is very tiny. And the most of the gas in the cloud is just remained in the surrounding envelope, and gas begins to start to accrete onto the protostar. So during this accretion stage, the stellar mass significantly increases because of the accretion. So this is a second accretion phase, and the important quantity for this accretion phase is accretion rate. Accretion rate on the protostar, so which is written by this equation, genes mass divided by freefall time, and this is actually depends only on the temperature. So this is the outline, and So initially, I'm talking about this early phase, early collapse phase, and so regarding the early collapse stage, the evolution is relatively well established like this. So because the full 3D cosmological simulation can follow the entire process from the cosmological initial condition all the way to the formation of the tiny protostar. So this is one example of Naoki's simulation. So this is a cosmological large-scale structure formation simulation. And you can see the mini halo here. So this is like kind of a cradle of the population three-star formation. So within this mini halo, the gas starts to collapse dynamically. And this figure shows the evolution. So here, the density increases in a runaway fashion. So this is a distance from the center, and this is the density. So you can see the self-similar profile of the density structure. And finally, the protostar is forming. But so this is a pop-up of the, you know, the protostar forming in this cosmological simulation. So this is a 300 parsec structure. So you can see the mini halo structure like here. And so if you zoom up in the central region, so there is a gas cloud. So actually, the cloud mass is very huge, 1,000 solar mass. And if you're zooming up, zooming in, so you can see the molecular flat rotating structure. So this is a circumstellar disk, kind of a circumstellar disk. And finally, the protostar itself is here. So this is a 25 solar radius scale. So this is a very tiny scale in comparison to the large scale structure formation. But finally, this star itself is well resolved in this large scale cosmological simulation. So this picture is relatively well established, but of course there are things to be solved still. So one thing is formation of wide binaries. So some cosmological simulation shows the fragmentation dwelling, gravitational fragmentation dwelling the initial cloud collapse stage. So like this Torx 2009 paper. So these are two fragments in separation of like 1,000 AU. So the separation is very large. And my collaborator, Shingo Hirano, did some statistical assessment of this large-scale fragmentation. But actually, this fragmentation might be very rare. About 5% of primordial clouds did show this large-scale fragmentation in the early phase of collapse stage. So maybe so these fragments can evolve to wide binaries, but we have to study the subsequent evolution in the accretion stage. So this is a stuff, and the other stuff is the amplification of the magnetic field. So some simulation like this shows the amplification of magnetic field by the turbulent dynamo during this initial phase. But actually, none of the simulation can get the numerical convergence to see how strong magnetic field can finally amplify during the collapse. So this is still an issue. So magnetic field is always an issue, but I don't talk about magnetic field anymore. So Jennifer Schober is talking about this later. So for the rest of my talk, we are mostly focusing on the subsequent evolution in the accretion stage. So this is a final snapshot of the initial collapse phase. But at this moment, the protostar is there, but the stellar mass is very tiny, like 10 to minus 2 solar mass. And this tiny protostar is surrounded by huge primordial gas cloud. So the problem is what happens next? What's happening next is like this. Here's a protostar, and the gas in the surrounding envelope begins to accrete on the protostar. And during this stage, the stellar mass significantly increased by mass accretion. So maybe the one final question is to ask what is the final mass of the protostar. But for fixing the final stellar mass, we have to study what will happen in this subsequent accretion stage. So as I said, the important quantity in this accretion phase is the accretion rate, which is written like this, genes must divided by free fall time. And this only depends on the temperature like this. So with a typical temperature of primordial gas, the typical accretion rate is like 10 to minus 3 solar mass per year. So this is actually huge. So for the massive stars, so the typical lifetime is mega year. So with the duration of mega year and with this accretion rate, you may be able to get 1,000 solar mass. So this is the reason why people are talking about the high mass star for the population 3 stars. But here, of course, we assume that this kind of rapid mass accretion should continue for the entire the lifetime of the star, massive star. So this is just an assumption. And so decent simulations actually that assumption doesn't stand. So this is a kind of one of my recent numerical simulation showing the protostar feedback actually terminate or stops the mass accretion onto the protostar. And as a result of this such feedback effect, the final stellar mass is significantly reduced by the from the previous estimate. So this figure shows what's happening. So this is time evolution. So as this, this is time evolution, and you can see the bipolar H region is forming like this. So as you know, as I said, the stellar mass is always increasing by the mass accretion, and the stellar luminosity is always increasing, and as a result, the bipolar H region is growing. So H region can penetrate to the envelope to the polar direction because the density is lower to the polar direction. And this panel shows the evolution of the accretion rate. This blue curve is this is a stellar mass, and this is the accretion rate. And now the stellar mass is always increasing with time. So this is a kind of time. So you can see the accretion rate. So this blue line shows the evolution for this case, and you can see the accretion rate drops at some point, and the accretion almost terminates around here. And this red line shows the evolution for the same case, but without feedback. So this difference shows the importance of feedback. And for this one particular case, the accretion rate is significantly reduced by the stellar UV feedback. And for this case, the stellar mass is, it's still massive, but ordinary massive, like a 43 solar mass star. So for this simulation, so we performed the 2D radiation hydro simulation, but actually the very essential thing is the protostellar evolution. Actually, protostellar evolution can control the strength of the UV feedback from the star. So this is one example by Kazuo Mukai and Francesco Palla. So in this simulation, they are solving the interior structure of accreting protostar. So this panel shows the evolution of the radius. So this is the mass and radius. And different lines show the evolution with different accretion rate. So the behavior of stellar radius is a bit tricky, but initially the stellar radius gradually increases, but at some point the protostar begins to contract. And actually this contraction is very important for determining the strength of UV feedback, because the UV luminosity increasing during this contraction stage, and UV feedback always operates around here. So if the UV feedback works or not sensitively depends on this protostellar evolution. So as I said, the UV feedback operates when the star shrinks, and when the star shrinks actually depends on the accretion rate, right? So the following the stellar evolution is very important, or even essential for determining the strength of UV feedback. And in my simulation, actually, I also follow the stellar evolution simultaneously with the radiation hydro simulation. So that means the stellar evolution, following stellar evolution is very important. And one recent progress on the stellar evolution, protostellar evolution, is like this. So this panel shows one of my results. And so let's think about very rapid mass accretion with accretion rate of like 10 to minus 2 solar mass per year or more. So this rapid accretion is recently discussed because of the direct collapse scenario, so which is proposed to explain the existence of supermassive black hole in the early universe. But anyway, so this is this shows the evolution of radius again. So this is the mass and this is the radius, and this different line shows the different evolution with different accretion rate. And this is a standard case with 10 to minus 3 solar mass per year. So this is a typical for the normal population three star formation. So in this case, as I showed, the star begins to contract at some point. So this contraction is important for the UV feedback, but with higher accretion rate, something different occurs, actually. So this is evolution of with the accretion rate of 6 times 10 to minus 3 solar mass per year. And this is a higher rate, so 3 times 10 to minus 2 and 6 times 10 to minus 2 solar mass per year. So with this rapid accretion, with the accretion rate exceeding 0.01 solar mass per year, the protostar actually never contracts, like this. the stellar radius always increasing with mass. And this, the protostar continues to expand. So this might be important because this contraction is essential to control the UV feedback, as I said. So this similar, the expansion is also suggested by Dominique Schreicher and Francesco Palla also. But recently, there is some objection by Li and Yun. So maybe he's presenting the poster here. And as I said, the stellar evolution is a key. Protostellar evolution is key to determine the UV feedback and finally the stellar mass. But the stellar evolution sensitively depends on the mass accretion rate. So then, so you can expect some diversity of the stellar evolution and the stellar mass finally. So. So we did this kind of statistical study. So because we want to derive the mass distribution of population three star finally. So what we did is just picking up a number of star forming clouds from a large scale cosmological simulation like this, and we are picking up a number of star forming clouds like this. And then follow the subsequent evolution until the stellar mass is fixed by UV feedback. So like this. So at some point, so this is the initial cosmological large-scale structure formation simulation. And at some point, we switch to the local 2D radiation hydro simulation, and then follow the evolution in the later accretion stage until the mass accretion onto the protostar is completely shut off by the feedback effect. So this is a local 2D radiation hydro simulation. But as I said, the stellar evolution is important, and we also solve the stellar evolution simultaneously with this radiation hydro simulation. So this is one of the results. So this is actually a kind of a mass distribution of the population three stars. So this is a mass, and this is a numbers. So for deriving this figure, our previous student, Shingo Hirano, did great work. So he finally analyzed more than 1,000 star forming clouds taken from the cosmological simulation. And with such analysis, we derived the mass distribution of population three stars. So here, the stellar mass is 100. So you can see a number of ordinary massive stars, like several times 10 solar mass star. But we also have a large population of very massive star, like a few times 100 solar mass star. So this is the current situation. But as I said, this is still a 2D simulation result. So the next step is also, of course, to going to the 3D simulation. And 3D effect has been suggested for long years. So early, this kind of simulation shows that disk fragmentation should be important. So what's happening here is like this. So here is a protostar, and the gas in the envelope begins to accrete, but there is some finite angular momentum, and the circumstellar disk also grows as accretion advances. And this circumstellar disk easily becomes gravitationally unstable, and sometimes such a circumstellar disk can gravitationally unstable to fragment. So this panel figure shows such gravitational fragmentation, and in this case, one concern is, so in this case, there's no high mass star may form. So instead, a cluster of low mass stars is a final outcome, and no massive star finally forms. So this this picture can change the grand framework. But there is one caution. So this, in this simulation, the spatial resolution is very high to resolve the this tiny small scale fragmentation. The typical resolution is less than 1 AU. But following the long term evolution with this high resolution is very difficult. And so there is some so with this high accretion rate, actually the evolution for some short duration is followed. typical duration of the simulation is like 10 or 1,000 years. So this depends on the adapted spatial resolution. So this is actually well before massive stars may form. So with this simulation, so you cannot investigate if the high mass star will finally form or not. So as I showed, the fragmentation may be important, but that actually means the high mass star is almost impossible with this fragmentation. So this is one example. This is a simulation by Thomas Greif. So in this simulation, he adopted very high spatial resolution. He doesn't use any sync particle technique. But instead, he only follows that very short duration, like 10 years, after the formation of embryo protostar. So as I said, in this simulation, so he could get a number of fragments. But actually, most of the fragments can finally merge without surviving. So this is the evolution of the production rate of sync, protostar actually, the star, the number of fragments. So this is the total number of fragments, and this dashed line actually is the number of merged fragments. So this panel shows about 2/3 of fragments actually merged away, and only 1/3 survived, for example, by the gravitational ejection. And so this merger of fragments occurs because of the inward migration in the disk. So you can see, there is a number of fragments within the disk, but each fragment can migrate because of the gravitational torque through the circumstellar disk. And finally, this frequent merger occurs. So finally, high mass stars will still form even with lots of fragmentation. So this is a suggestion of this simulation. And this, as I said, this simulation didn't adopt any sync particle technique, so they derived the rotation law within the star. So this is one example. So this is a paper by Stacy, 2012. They analyzed the simulation by Thomas Greif, and they didn't use any sync technique. So this is one snapshot. You can see the disk structure here, and the protostar is here. But as I said, so this simulation is very computationally expensive, and so this is a very early stage of the star formation. This is just 10 years later, 10 years after the formation of very tiny embryo star. The stellar mass at this snapshot is only 0.5 solar mass. But there is this panel shows the internal profile of the rotation. So this is the distance from the stellar center, and this is the rotational velocity. And this solid line shows the profile of rotational velocity, and this is the Kepler velocity. So the derived rotation is very strong. So strong rotation is suggested, like 50% or 100% of Kepler rotation near the surface. But as I said, this simulation only shows a snapshot in the very beginning. It's only for the very early epoch of 10 years after the birth of the protostar. OK, so this shows a 3D effect might be important, but this is just a beginning, well before the UV feedback will operate. And of course, the next step is to include the feedback effect in this kind of 3D simulation. So this is kind of a cutting edge of this field. So a number of people are working on this kind of simulation. So to investigate the interplay because the UV feedback and gravitational fragmentation. So I will explain some of this. And one example of this work by Susa-san. So they derived the mass spectrum with this multiplicity. So there is a multiplicity because the gravitational fragmentation should occur with this 3D simulation. And so in this, for some of these cases, a few or several protostars finally survived instead of only one massive star. So they performed a number of the 3D radiation hydrodynamic, the 3D RHD simulation, but only with 5 feedback because of the resolution issue. And they investigated more than 60 mini halos, and they followed the 10 to 5 years evolution with 10 AU resolution. So this panel shows the typical multiplicity they get in their simulation. So this is the number of stars in the mini halo, and this is the number of mini halo. So this 1 means a single star is forming in the mini halo, but these mini halos show some multiplicity, suggest some multiplicity of the protostar. The typical multiplicity in their simulation is several, you know, like 4 or 5, the several multiplicity for mini halo. And as a result, this is the mass distribution. So this is the stellar mass, and this is you know, the number of stars. So this is a kind of similar with our previous result with 2D simulation, but the typical stellar mass is a bit lower because of this fragmentation effect. You know, the star of individual, the star is a bit lower than the 2D simulation. So this is one suggestion. But actually, this multiplicity sensitively depends on the spatial resolution. So this is a more recent numerical resolution by Athena Stacey, and they also did a RHD numerical simulation. And in their simulation, both EUV and 5 feedback is included, and one good thing is they adopted very high spatial resolution, spatial resolution 1 AU, so which is 10 times better than the previous work. But with this high resolution, of course, the computation is very expensive, and they follow only 5,000 years. And they studied only 1 mini halo. So this panel shows the evolution of the production rate of sync particle. So this is the time of, this is the number of sync. This is the formation rate of sync particle. And this is a number of sync particle finally merged away. And this solid line shows us the sync particle finally survived. And so you can see the multiplicity for this case is very high. So the number of sync particles is here is 100 and here is 50. So the multiplicity is you know, much higher than the previous studies with lower resolution. So this is a mass distribution. So this is a mass and this is a number. So as I said, they only studied only one case, or only one you know, star forming cloud in mini halo, but because of this you know, frequent fragmentation, so they derive the mass distribution of fragments. So here is a one solar mass. So they with high resolution they get a number of low mass stars. Yeah, like 0.1 solar mass. And this blue line shows distribution with a low, their low resolution case. So this population with a low in this low mass end is very sensitive to the spatial resolution. With higher resolution, you can get a more number of low mass objects. And typical, you know, the number of fragment is decreasing with higher resolution. And because of the higher resolution, they resolve the, you know, tight binary. The separation less than 10 AU can be resolved with this high resolution simulation. For example, the binary fraction in the simulation is like 30% of survival syncs, but one of this binary is this kind of massive tight binary. So massive, the member star is 13 solar mass and 14 solar mass star, but separation is only 5 AU. And this 5 AU separation binary cannot resolve with the 10, for example, the 10 AU spatial resolution. So this is you know, outcome of the high resolution simulation. So this tight binary may be important because, you know, the recent LIGO gravitational wave detection may be from the massive black hole binary as a remnant of population 3 stars. So there is some discussion like this. And some of them will post a presentation later. Okay, I'll skip this part. And so the final question I'm asking is what about the high mass end of population 3 stars. Actually, there is another uncertainty of the high mass end. So as I said, even with gravitational fragmentation of the disk, the accretion should be possible because the fragment, each fragment can migrate inward because of the gravitational torque. But in that case, for that case, the mass accretion rate should be very variable, you know, time dependent. So this is the time evolution of the accretion rate from the Bobrov 2013 simulation. So this is accretion rate, and here the accretion rate is 10 to minus 3 solar mass per year. So you can see the accretion rate is very, you know, time dependent, very variable. And so you can see some spiky structure like this, and sometimes the accretion, mass accretion can become very rapid, or so this kind of short burst of accretion can happen. And remember that the stellar evolution can change with this kind of rapid accretion. So with this high accretion rate, the protostar can inflate like this. And the outcome is like this. So this is one of the movie. So actually this is a formation of H2 region. So the UV feedback is going on, but you can see the formation and extinction of H2 region because in this case, the mass accretion is very time dependent, and sometimes you can get a very high accretion rate for short accretion burst. In that case, the protostar can expand, and the UV luminosity of protostar suddenly decreased by that effect. So as a result, the UV feedback can operate only intermittently. So with this intermittent UV feedback, the mass accretion may not be efficiently halted. So this is another uncertainty of the evolution. OK, so let me summarize. And so a number of simulations are still going on, but the cutting edge is a kind of 3D RHD simulation. And these kind of simulations are revealing the formation process of population 3 stars. And typical picture, the current picture predicts the typical population of 3 stars should be typically a high mass, and typical stellar mass should be around a few times 10 or 100 solar mass. Of course, there are some barriers to form high mass star, like gravitational fragmentation and UV feedback. But at least under some conditions, so you can get this kind of high mass stars. And the multiplicity and rotation is still unknown, but some early results suggest a very high multiplicity and rapid rotation. And the maximum and minimum stellar mass is more or less uncertain. And for further understanding, to extend our understanding, so we need, of course, we need more simulations. So what kind of simulations? Of course, long-term radiation hydro simulation with high resolution, high spatial resolution should be better. But so this is always awaited. And so one important thing is, incorporating the physics of stellar evolution is important because for the UV feedback effect, the protostellar evolution is essential stuff. So the adequately incorporating the physics of stellar evolution should be a key. Okay, so I will stop here.
So thank you, Takashi, for this very nice review of what we know about first star formation and mm-hmm. where there are many question marks in this field. Mm-hmm. So the podium is open for questions and discussions. Please raise your hand. Okay, Daniel Whalen. It's the first one. Stefan?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
All right.
Yeah.
So can you repeat the question? I'm not sure everyone has heard it.
Maybe he's asking the effect of magnetic field, in particular for the evolution in the late accretion stage. Is that the question?
Or even during the formation of the protostellar disk.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, of course, the importance of magnetic field should depend on the strength of magnetic field. But naively, so I can expect the with magnetic field, some angular momentum should be subtracted from the system, and maybe for some cases the formation of disk might be prevented by such effect. So with sufficiently strong magnetic field, the star formation should become like a spherical, right? So that's the extreme case. But naively, the formation of disk should be delayed at least, and the fragmentation of the disk should be suppressed as a result, I think.
Omukai-san, you had a graph in the beginning. In the beginning, you had a graph where you showed the mass spectrum, or somewhere in the between the mass spectrum, and on the bottom you had hydrogen, molecular hydrogen cooling in one range,
okay.
And in another range you had molecular hydrogen and
so
HD cooling.
So you're talking about this figure, right?
This is not. There's no figure right now.
Sorry.
I see. Anyway. In two different mass ranges, you had two different cooling processes.
Right.
And can you explain this a little bit more?
Yes. So normally, the pure population three star formation is occurs only with the hydrogen molecular cooling. But so think about the kind of a slow contraction with, for example, with a high angular momentum. For some cases, contraction should be delayed. And compressional heating should be also reduced. With such, for such cases, the temperature can reach like 100 Kelvin, a bit lower than the typical temperature. For such case, the HD molecule can form. So, the formation of HD molecule is triggered. And with this HD molecule formation, so you can get additional cooling process, and temperature can get lower more.
So let's thank Takashi.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.